in the dream, I realized that I didn't have much time left. The plane was due to leave that day or the next day. So if I was going to explore this unknown island, I'd better get busy. And then I would find myself hiking or taking an automobile to what appeared to be the edge of rainforest on a distant hill. And I would get up to it in the dream, all prepared to work and find all these marvelous native species and so on of ants. And arriving it, I would find, no, it was just a single row of trees, like a windbreak, and on the other side, more fields. And then I would wake up. And I said to myself in the course of all this, well, you know, it was a symbolism in my mind of what had happened to these places I love so much. So I kept wondering, and in my dreams, as it repeated itself, I gradually became aware of what these islands, exactly what they were. It was the Wallis and Futuna group, a little-known archipelago between New Caledonia and Fiji. Never been studied for ants, and it's just the kind of place, you know, you'd want to go to be the first. So I said to myself in my waking moments, if I can't get to Wallis and Futuna myself, I'll send a student. So I managed to get an undergraduate who was going to Australia shortly and who'd been trained, you know, working on ants. And I asked him if he would take a detour to the Wallis and Futuna Islands. They're under French control, I believe. And he said, oh, yes. And quite an adventure for him. And he did, and he collected thoroughly. And then when he came back with the specimens, we actually did a monograph on the ants of the Wallis and Futuna. The dream did not stop. But now I was not on the Wallis and Futuna. I was back on New Caledonia in my dream. And I couldn't get rid of that by going to New Caledonia and sending somebody to New Caledonia. It was only after a long time that the dream faded. Unfortunately, the reality of the destruction of biodiversity and the natural environment that inspired the dream did not fade.